I'm Leslie Henninger. I'm a pilot examiner for the FAA. I'm not employed by them, thank goodness, but I do work at their discretion in everything I do. They tell me what to do and tell me how to conduct these check rides. So what I hope to do is illuminate for you how these check rides are handled and what we're looking for. The reason I originally started doing these seminars is because people generally come to the flight test extremely nervous. And this almost invariably affects performance in some way or another, and sometimes people get frozen and can't quite do what they want to do. So let me assure you that we're just looking to see that you're a good pilot and you meet the standards that the FAA has given us. With some, you know, we have some flexibility. That's why it's still human beings testing human beings. I became an examiner in 1994, and prior to that, I had done, amazingly, about 9,000 hours of flight instruction. A lot of people think I have a screw loose when they hear that, but really, I actually enjoyed flight instructing and still do when I have the time to do it. But the FAA thought that that was a reasonably good background for giving check rides, and after being put through the mill with them, I became a designated examiner. But one thing remains true throughout my flying career, and that is that I will be doing check rides for the rest of my life, probably, taking them. So I totally sympathize with everybody's nerves, because I still am nervous every time I have to go to the FAA, which is two or three times a year to be checked. And that's the FAA, and they're not as friendly as I am, so. And they're not as flexible as we are either. But I've handed out some newsletters that I published a while ago, and they address some issues about taking the check rides, addressing the nerves that people have, and how to prepare yourself. And one of the really good ways to prepare yourself is to come to one of these meetings, because you get to see that I'm kind of a normal person, and you know, I'm just a human being like everybody else, so we can interact a little bit, and it sometimes relieves your anxiety. And in the back of this packet, there's a set of notes which is loosely organized as I'm going to present the material. So if you want to take a couple notes on there, you can do that. We have materials to guide us through all of this. And the discussion today, I'm going to mainly focus on VFR check rides, so private and commercial. We want to emphasize that this is a practical test. So we're not testing the rote knowledge that you had for your written test. We're testing your ability to function in the real world. So to the extent possible, our goal is to create scenarios, either verbally or in flight to the extent that we can, that would duplicate things you might experience either in your private or commercial flying operations. So you'll hear a lot of stories being told. You won't be asked rote questions like, what's the visibility requirement in EE airspace? You'll be asked a more general question about the trip that you plan for the cross country. We'll get into more detail on that. But we do have reference material. You can bring as much as you want of this stuff to your flight test. But the PTS, the practical test standards, is essential. We'll talk some about what you can find in there that's useful. Obviously, current charts and material, FARs. Don't have a whole lot of private people looking things up in the FARs, but if you have them handy, it certainly could be useful to you. The weather books that the FAA puts out, and the current airplane flying handbook, which replaced the flight training handbook. So this is newly released and improved. So be sure you're using those references. You can use books that are similar to this. You can use Kirshner, as long as Kirshner doesn't disagree with the FAA, because the FAA wins in that contest. But usually they're pretty consistent on materials. Obviously, you'll need, in addition to the PTS and these other books, you'll need your handbook for the airplane. So bring one of those along. At the very beginning, of course, we're going to start with your application. And I'd like to just talk about a few things on this. This is the first thing that I look at. If you have mistakes on the application, it makes you feel really bad. So you should be sure that you fill this out, your instructor goes over it with you, and keep the errors to a minimum. For your instructors, try to date the back the same as the date on the front. It can work another way, but it's hard to remember which way that is. But the instructor is supposed to sign first. But if you sign them the same day, it's fine. So remember that there's a page attached to this, usually, that's the instructions. So if you read the instructions as you're filling it out, you're not going to be making some of the common mistakes. Some of the common mistakes would be just starting across the top here. Last, first, middle name has to be in that order. If you're taking your second check ride, it has to appear as it appears on your first certificate. Social Security number, the movement is now to eliminate those. So probably we'd all be well advised to start writing do not use in there. Anybody who gets a new certificate now is going to get a new random number. So if you're currently using your Social Security number, it's going to be changed for you. That isn't my doing. It's just when they send it to Oklahoma City, it's going to be changed automatically. This is obviously an applicant for a private test. And one of the key things that can cause some trouble is the student pilot certificate. These obviously are way out of date. But remember that the student pilot certificate part of the medical is only good for 2 years. And the medical itself, if you're under 40, is good for 3 years. So you could be walking around with a 2.5-year-old medical that's good, but the student certificate is no good. If you're soloing during that period of time where the student pilot certificate isn't valid, you're in violation of the FARs. Now, I'm not a cop for the FAA, and the hours actually will count towards the rating. But you sure wouldn't want to be stopped on the ramp soloing, flying on an invalid student certificate. So make sure that that's kept within 2 years. Even though the medical is good for 36 months if you're young. That'd be a pretty common mistake. The hours and everything your instructor will work out with you. But try to get this right so that we don't have to start making changes. It just makes you feel real uncomfortable. So try to get this right. Sometimes it can put an end to the test if your instructor isn't around, so it's nice if the instructor is there. Back into the PTS, they give you a list of the things that are required, you're required to bring with you for the check ride. The airplane's records, we have to have access to the aircraft documents. Obviously, the ones in the airplane should be there. Know where they are. Don't go out to the airplane and be unable to find these documents for me. As far as the maintenance records go, the most popular way of doing this is to have a summary sheet and fill out all the dates that you find for the specific airplane, for the annual 100-hour pedostatic test, transponder, all of that. Also, people like to put the post-it notes into the actual maintenance records, which is fine. Just remember that the mechanic will not move the post-it note when he does the next 100-hour. So don't just leave the historical post-it notes in there without checking that you've got the right thing. You are going to be able to have to find these inspections, so don't rely on the fact that your instructor showed you where the annual was and you wrote down the date on a summary sheet. We upped the ante a little bit on the commercial, and we're going to get into more detail on aircraft airworthiness on that. The view-limiting device, I have a personal bias against boggles because I don't think they work for most people. I found that a lot of people can get peripheral information and they're not really having a view limiting situation. So probably if you're over 5'8 and you show up with foggles, I'll probably suggest that we put on some other type of device. And really, in your own interest, you should want to have a view limiting device where you can't see outside, because we're trying to make sure that you can save your life. Current charts, unless it looks really ratty, I haven't been looking at the dates, but you know, you're supposed to have current charts. When they're all torn up, I start looking at the dates, and then I wonder why you didn't buy a new one, even if it was current. And the current AIM and that kind of thing. We'll need a photo ID, and this is usually your driver's license. We're all going to have to carry driver's licenses now, so this is how we're avoiding having picture IDs on our pilot certificate. So just have something, or your passport if you're driving on a ticket like I am about half the time. But I never break the speed limits in airplanes. If they gave me a bigger airplane, I might. But so this is in your PTS. Refer to that. Also in the PTS is the list of tasks that you're going to have to do. And it tells you in there, obviously, which ones you're going to have to do. There are very few choices on a private test, very few choices on a commercial test, but sometimes there is a little discretion on the part of the examiner, like in ground reference maneuvers, for example, on the private test. So you can review that. And each of these tasks, when you look at the detail, has reference material attached to it. It says which publications they relied on to determine how they want this done. And a lot of them are going to be referring to this and the other FAA handbooks, the FARs. They'll say this is our reference material for it. Also in the introduction, which a lot of people overlook, are the standards for passing this test. So satisfactory performance means that you can perform the tasks in the areas of operation within the approved standards. Now, interestingly, they say on a normal day. The standards are for a normal day. But we don't have too many normal days. I don't know what that would be. But, you know, if you've been out the last couple days, you know it's been pretty turbulent. So I couldn't hold you to the altitude requirements for a normal day if it's really turbulent. But what you have to be doing is taking prompt corrective action anytime you get outside the standards. So you can't get 500 feet off on your altitude and pay no attention to it. You know, get 300 feet off and then correct it or show everybody that you're working on that. Demonstrate mastery of the aircraft with a successful outcome of each task, never seriously in doubt. Okay, seriously in doubt is when the examiner starts speaking in an elevated tone to you, issuing commands. And then the really bad one is when the examiner says, I have the aircraft, because that means you failed the test. So examiner intervention is when the outcome was seriously in doubt. And so that's a landmark of you failed that task. Satisfactory proficiency and competency within the approved standards, we talked about that. Sound judgment, that's kind of why we tell stories, because it's hard to evaluate judgment on a Checkride day. But an example I can think of is if you're a commercial applicant and you're asked to do a short field landing on a gusty day. Now, some people would think that I want to see the minimum airspeed that the manual prescribes for this maneuver, which tells me that you don't understand about wind shear. So I want to see you exercise pilot judgment. So don't be trying to read my mind, because I want to see how you're going to function as a pilot, not whether you know what the minimum airspeed is this airplane could fly at on a calm day. And there's a lot of judgment stories we do in the oral as well. Single pilot competence, so you can't be using me as an assistant. Okay, now the unsatisfactory performance they're talking about there, they're basically saying that once you fail a task, if it's clearly failed, and I don't see any opportunity to test the same sort of thing later, because we're really not allowed to repeat, but truthfully, some of us do. We'll just find a different crosswind and see how that one looks, you know, unless the first one was just too scary that I had to intervene. But can't repeat things, but once it's clearly a fail on a task, you'll be told, or it'll be conveyed to you. It's real hard on an applicant for us to say you failed that task, because it's hard for them to move forward from that point. So I'll generally say something like, well, it appears that you've exceeded some standards on this task. Let's see how it goes. And hopefully, I encourage you to keep yourself engaged, because if the pilot can stay engaged in the flight, even though he's just gotten some really bad news, and let's say later on, I get to see a really good crosswind landing, I could forget the first one. So we like to keep the pilot engaged in the flight test, if possible. It also says in here that you're only going to continue the test if there's been a failed item, if you both agree on it. So it's up to you if you want to continue the test. If you end up with only slow flight as a failure, then you'll only have one task to redo. Some pilots can't get their head back into the game, and if I see that's happening, I'll just say, look, let's terminate this, and we'll come back and do the things that we haven't done and do the thing that you failed. But, you know, try to stay in the game. It puts up a very good appearance. Okay, so the failure items are any lack of action that requires corrective intervention. I talked about that. Failure to use proper scanning, obviously really critical, important for all of us in this area and really any area. Consistently exceeding the tolerances stated in the objective. Well, consistently exceeding kind of sounds like all the time, doesn't it? So if you're all the time out of the standards, then I'd have to say you're consistently exceeding. If it's 90, 70, 60, then I get to exercise some judgment. So this is where the conditions of the day get involved. But they come to point four, which is failure to take prompt corrective action when the tolerances are exceeded. So keep working on it. Just keep working on it. Try and stay within those tolerances. All right, we're going to skip back to this one because in this PTS, they also have a list. And thankfully, they finally broke it out into a list. Special emphasis areas used to be buried in a paragraph. Now they give you a list. Each of these PTSs has the special emphasis areas outlined, and they change from time to time. So they just dropped out wind shear, so I kind of don't ask about wind shear anymore since it can shorten up the test a little bit, and everybody was getting it right anyway. And they've added in land and hold short operations. All of these items are going to be things that have caused death or mayhem in aviation. These are emphasized because people have hurt themselves and they're causing problems in aviation. So they want us to be the gatekeepers so that these things are taken care of. So runway incursion avoidance, number 7, doesn't really show up as a task in the PTS, but there is airport operations. So if you run over the hold short line, you would fail airport operations because you didn't hold short or you were told to hold short. Obviously, I can't let you run over it, but I let you get pretty close so you can't tell me I was going to stop right then. Positive exchange of controls. They have broken that out to talk in depth about it. This is how serious they are about this one. The FAA wants a 3-step process. So it's, if I want to take the plane from you so you can put the hood on, I'll say, I have the flight controls. You then say, you have the flight controls. Then I say, I have the flight controls. Seems like almost one too many, but they have their reasons. This apparently resulted from the fact, and you say flight controls rather than airplane or aircraft, because somebody at some point said, I have the airplane, when he was answering a traffic call. And the other crew member gave up control of the airplane. And so without the response going on, and with the confusion of saying aircraft or airplane, it was ineffective, and nobody was flying for a while. So try to get into the habit of saying flight controls. The use of distractions, I don't really find too many reasons to have to distract you. I figure I'm just like, I'm a big, giant distraction. And plus, in the airspace we're flying in, it's pretty distracting. So I kind of leave you alone. In fact, it might seem unnaturally quiet to you, but that's just because I'm there as an observer. I'm not there to be a co-pilot, or I'm not there to interact or chat you up. So I just pretty much leave you alone. Let's see. Crew resource management is another area that they talk about and break out as a special emphasis area. Now, it says it's not limited to cabin crew members. So that means that there are other people out there who are your resources. So there's air traffic controllers that you can call and get help from. If you didn't hear what he said, your co-pilot, me, isn't going to tell you what he said, but you can ask him again. So he's a resource for you. Lots of resources that we want people to be able to take advantage of. And we test you about that on the ground, as to how you use the stuff that's available to you. Oh, use of checklists, pretty significant. They're not do lists, they're checklists. So there's certain functions in a simple airplane that we do from memory. Like the carburetor heat comes on in a 172, you reduce the power. You don't really have to check that the gear's down because it's welded. And so, you know, if you do the memory items and you get them all done, then I'd have to say that you did the checklist. Now, if you started the airplane from memory, did the run-up from memory, and never looked at the checklist, ever, that's not an effective way to use a checklist. The PTS, I think, has 22 references. The private PTS has at least 22 references to use of checklists in various tasks. There's even a cruise checklist for a Skyhawk, which is set the power and trim it and lean the mixture if appropriate. Most people do these from memory. You get into the more complex airplanes for the commercial test, you should be on the checklist, or at least accomplishing a checklist and then reviewing that you did it. So clearly, you can do it that way. If your engine fails at 1,000 feet and you start digging out a checklist, this would be an abuse of a checklist. These are things that you should have committed to memory. So you can get yourself too wrapped up in the checklist to do an effective job of flying the airplane. Land and hold short, I'm sure you guys are used to hearing it if you fly out of here. I'll show you an example of how I ask about that on the ground. Aeronautical decision making is kind of judgment, checklists we talk about. Stall spin awareness. There are people that come to the test and they kind of know how to get out of a spin, but they leave out a step here and there. Now, according to the FAA, I should take that extremely seriously. And I do. But for a private pilot who describes the power off, ailerons, neutral, opposite rudder, but forgets to tell me to break the stall, which is the one that they usually leave out, briskly move the wheel forward, we'll talk about it. You know, I'll say, did you do anything? Is this a stalled condition? Did you do anything to stop the stall? So we talk about it a little bit. We wouldn't have that much tolerance on a commercial pilot. So have that committed to memory. That's something that you wouldn't be able to look up. So stall spin awareness is going to be on all these tests. Carol did a nice job on the weather, and she had nice exhibits for the maps, which is excellent. So if you bring all those maps and you understand them, that's excellent. But we're also going to have some printed material. So you can either bring it this way, which is the coded, or you can bring it in the plain English version. If you have a way of getting it printed in plain English, I have no reason to think that you wouldn't do that in your everyday life. So this being a practical test, you can bring it printed in English and all extended for you. If you're going to bring the coded ones, you might want to buy one of those little decoder books. I saw a really nice one that had all the little acronyms, all the abbreviations in there. It's a really good book, and you can certainly use that. So we'll go through a couple of these. If you just take notes from a phone briefing, I might bring out something and have you look it over. Certainly on a day where there's low-level wind shear mentioned, I'd like you to know what that means and how it affects your flight. If there aren't any air mets for the day, I'd ask you what kind of information would be in the air mets, and you should have a general idea of that. Obviously, the commercial pilots, we go into a little more detail. So have at least detailed notes from a weather briefing. And remember that you're going to get the weather all the way to your destination. I have to know if you're going to make a go or a no-go decision. And if you don't have the information in Cedar Rapids or in Peoria, then we don't know if you're going to go or not. So you have to have the information for the whole trip. And obviously, your flight planning is going to depend on that, too. OK, then we get into performance. And obviously, one of the first things we're going to talk about is weight and balance, because the rest of the performance is going to hinge on that. So this is a Cessna graph. The graphs typically look pretty much the same. The red X is typically where we are in a checkride. And you get used to seeing what it looks like with us two in the airplane and nobody in the back. So if the X doesn't look like it's in the right spot, I'm going to, you know, start looking at it closer. If you bring me a plane where the X is the green X, what can I say? But we're not going anywhere. Or I'm going to ask you, what are we going to do about this? And you better say, well, I'm having them offload some fuel, or I'm not taking my 30-pound bag with me anymore. We're required to talk about stability. So what I do is I put the blue X on there and say, which of these positions would you prefer to have for flight test? And, you know, given the flight test maneuvers, not the cross country. So we need to find out if you know which side of the graph is the forward CG and which you prefer, and if you have a good reason for preferring it. So most people get this one. You want to be in the forward position, and what maneuvers would this affect the most? It would be your stalls. So then we get to go into the stall discussion, define what a stall is. And I'll say if we're out there doing a power on stall, I look at the turn coordinate and the ball's all the way out to the right. Is that okay? And the answer is no. How would you fix it? Step on the ball. Okay, if you didn't do that, what would happen? Go into a spin, perhaps. And how do you get out of a left or right spin, whichever one we created there? I might ask which position you'd like for the cross country if we're actually going on the cross country. And so we like the aft CG because we're going to do a little better in performance. Okay, then we now that we know the weight, we have takeoff distances to work out. So the Cessna ones, really easy. Nobody has a problem with those typically. I see a lot of people interpolating between 4 or 6 or 8 numbers on these graphs. It's interesting that you know the math, and I would certainly expect a flight instructor to address that subject with their student. But in reality, if there's a 30-foot difference, are you really going to take a 30-foot shorter runway than the longer one? So if you're telling me a story like, well, we would interpolate between these numbers, but I think I'll just take the higher temperature. I'll just take the higher pressure altitude. If you're showing me all that kind of judgment, it makes perfect sense to me. And it seems to me like you're going to be a good, safe pilot exercising judgment. I have, periodically, I ask, once you get these numbers, like the underlined in red, 1,510 feet to clear an obstacle. Somebody gives me that number as a hard number. I say, all right, what's the shortest runway you'd be willing to use? Well, if they're telling me it takes 1,500 feet to clear a 50-foot obstacle, and they're happy with a 1,500-foot runway, they don't even have a clear picture of what a 1,500-foot runway looks like. So let's be cautious about that. Piper makes it a little more difficult. And I would say the weak point with people doing the oral, the flight test in a Piper, is these graphs. Because I think they may get shown them once, but never again, perhaps. So sometimes it looks like they've never seen this when they bring the book to me. And so what you're starting here is you just follow their example, but you're starting with the temperature, go over to a reference line, down to your weight, over to another reference line, down to a 5-knot headwind in this case, and over for your feet. That's all good. These altitudes are pressure altitudes. Unless the private pilot brings it up, I'm not going to pester him about it, but a commercial pilot should know how to find pressure altitude. And I don't really care to sit through a math problem, but if I tell you the pressure is 3020, I'd like to know that you know that that will have the effect of lowering the field elevation. It's almost a flip of a coin if people are going to get that going the right direction. But you just have to think about, where is there more pressure? Lower down. Okay. Then, let's see, we'll have another one here. This is now the same day and the same wind, or the same temperature, the same wind, the same weight, but we're at a higher elevation. So we have to talk about adverse conditions. I'll ask you to give me a list of adverse conditions. Clearly, more weight, higher altitude, higher temperature, tailwind. I'll ask a question. If you figured out from your material that you could save 100 feet from a headwind, if you decided to go the other way on the runway, would you merely add 100 feet? And the answer is no. It's about 5 times the penalty. So you need to know that there is an exponential change. Here you got a very slowly slanting line, and the tailwind slants up at a big angle. And in the Cessna, the notes tell you how big the penalty is for tailwind. So we'll be talking about this hot day in Denver for a takeoff. Actually, it isn't a hot day. It's kind of a cool day. But anyway, we're talking about a hot day in Denver because you told me that was a bad place to do a takeoff. So what can you do to improve the takeoff performance of the airplane? A lot of people want to throw on some flaps. I don't think there's much evidence that this is going to help you fly away from the ground. It may get you airborne, but it's not going to help you climb away from the ground. What we're really looking for is buried in the detail in the Piper takeoff and right on the notes for the takeoff chart for the Cessna. It says if you're at high altitude, you want to lean the mixture. Well, what power setting are you going to lean the mixture at? Well, full power, because that's the power setting you're using for takeoff. What airspeed are you going to rotate at? Same or different? A lot of people want to say you're going to go faster in Denver. Well, you're just eating up runway for no particularly good reason except to get a good launch. It's still not. It still will get airborne at the same airspeed because we're not talking ground speed. We're talking the indicated airspeed. This one. This is the big troubling one. Oh, not this one. This one and the next one probably. Okay, here we're talking about if you wanted to have 65% power, what power setting would you use? Well, the part that people get confused on is this. Is generally we know the temperature on the ground, but we don't know the temperature at the altitude. We could from the winds aloft, or we could by doing the lapse rate. However, Piper has conveniently put the standard temperature lapse rate in there for you. So if you're starting with the temperature on the ground, you slant up following the lapse rate temperature, because it's telling you how much to knock off. Or you could go with your 2 degrees per 1,000 feet, and you'll end up in exactly the same place. But slanting that line over is probably the biggest error that people make on this. Then we just go over to 65% power, and it says 2450, I guess, for 65% power. Then, true airspeed. Boy, oh boy, true airspeed. I'll tell you, private pilots want to tell me that their true airspeed, they'll say 100, 110, depends on the airplane, 109. How did you come up with that? Well, that's what it always is. That's a popular answer. And the other popular answer is, well, they don't really say this, but you can tell they want to say, my instructor told me. And I can remember when we did ground school on cross country that you're really anxious to go do the cross country, so sometimes we shortchange you a little bit as instructors. But this is where you get the true airspeed. The manufacturer publishes it. And the other popular one is to bring out the E6B, which means they're about to talk about ground speed. So here is where Piper tells us what the true airspeed is going to be. So if this is our 0-degree day, again, we don't know the temperature at 4,500 feet, so we have to follow that temperature lapse rate line sideways to where it enters 645. Go over to 65% power, which is what you told me you were going to use. And drop down, and we get to 104, somewhere in there. Yeah. So then, I'll ask, is that what the airspeed indicator is going to say? Some people say, oh, no, no, it's an old airplane. Okay, brand new airplane. Brand new airplane out of the box. Is that what the airspeed is going to say? Well, somewhere on here it says the fairings have to be installed. So, you know, that's a nice subtlety. It means they read the whole chart. But what we're looking for is, do you know the difference between indicated and true airspeed and how altitude change affects that? So unless it's a super cold day and you're flying at low altitude, the indicated is going to be lower than the true. But I don't go into much more detail than that. Said that right, didn't I? Yeah. So you can't tell me that you get it off the airspeed indicator, because what you see on the airspeed indicator is indicated and not true. Okay, Cessna's a little easier on these power true airspeed charts. You can just read it off the chart there, and it also gives you the gallons right next to it. Piper has the gallons kind of hidden up here. Some people find that difficult to pick out, so, you know. Sometimes I'll say, how many gallons are you using? And they'll open up the front page of the book, which is the little marketing spiel on how much it uses. But that's not going to be true for every flight condition. So then we get to talk about the fuel. This says they're going to use 7.7 gallons. I would say that on a flight test, maybe 10% of the people will lean it. Another 25%, if they're asked about it, will say, well, we're too low to need to lean it. Okay, there's some defense of that in the Cessna manual. But the fact is, if you don't lean it, you may never see this number. And it is not a brand new airplane. So this number, again, you should not be doing the math out to the tenth of a gallon. You should bump these numbers up to show me that you're exercising some judgment. So if that says 7.7, 8's good. 9 might be better. But don't rely on this to be a valid figure. And we also have to test you to the fuel consumption of the airplane for a trip of maximum length, or stretch out the trip to maximum range of the airplane. It's a little easier to do that by limiting the fuel on the airplane. So I'll tell the story about the airplane is not full of fuel, and you still want to go to Peoria or Cedar Rapids, and all the fuel trucks are broken. You have a dipstick that came from the factory, so you can dip the tanks and find out exactly how many gallons in the airplane. How many gallons would have to be in the airplane for you to want to take your trip to Peoria today or Cedar Rapids? So that means you have to know how much it's going to take in cruise, how much it's going to take to climb. It'd be nice if you put that in there. A lot of people forget to do that. You have to know what the regs are on the reserves. Now, the reserves, 30 minutes, I don't know. But people, if they say they want to land with 30 minutes and they're using 7.7, I say, okay, so that means you're willing to land with 3 gallons in each wing. Is that true? You know, 3.15 gallons in each wing? Oh, no, I would never do that, you know. So I want to hear you step up to the plate and say, I want an hour reserve at least, and I'm going to use 9 gallons an hour. Now, when you get into your commercial test, we may ask you to refine that a little bit, because at some point your employer might want you to not carry, he'd want you to carry more stuff and less gas. So that might get more critical there. Okay. Then we get into the actual cross-country part. I want to strongly recommend that you read the legend before the test. You know, I probably would refresh myself on something that I hadn't seen if I read the legend today, you know? So read the legend before the test. A lot of the stuff that you're going to have to answer is on here in one fashion or another. Okay. So you'll have your flight plan figured out. I don't ask you to plan the trip back. Sometimes I forget to tell you that, but you plan it both ways, that's okay, but you have to plan the trip at least to the destination. You want to pick your checkpoints, VFR checkpoints. You can use cross radials off of VORs to check a pilotage point, because I'll ask you how to do that anyway. But you're not supposed to be doing this test with any radio navigation. You're supposed to be doing it on pilotage, which means time and distance that you pre-measured, computing ground speeds. I'd say that pilotage is really one of the big weak areas in flight. And the FAA is aware of this because, you know, we're getting these GPSs available. Probably half the students are walking around with their secret pocket GPS anyway. And we may not be seeing too much pilotage done because these things are available. So certainly private level, you have to get your foundation, which is pilotage. Commercial level, obviously, you're supposed to have familiarity with all the navigation equipment in there, be able to use the GPS, but you're still going to be doing pilotage on the test. So I've seen commercial pilots get lost on their checkride, and it's pretty sad. You know, guy's a good pilot, he can do the rest of the flight test, he can do a perfect steep spiral with incredible winds. I had that the other day, but he flat out was lost, couldn't find where he was going. So you will be doing pilotage, and you will do pilotage to your deviation. So don't be expecting to hit the button and go direct. And then I had one instructor who thought he was doing a good job instructing. The plane had the GPS in it. And he said, oh, no, we're always doing pilotage. And I said, well, does he set up the destination? Oh, yeah. So I know that that pilot, when he was solo, he would just fly back to the purple line. He wasn't trying to find where he was on the ground when he got off course. He's just flying back to the purple line. It's only human nature. So as instructors, you'd be better off not teaching him how to use that to begin with, because this is high emphasis on pilotage. We'll start off talking about your checkpoints. I've seen a lot of different techniques, and one of the not good techniques would be every 10 miles, regardless of what's there. Well, it makes the math easy, but geez, once you got the E6B set up, you know, how hard is it to pick out different miles? So pick out checkpoints that are visible as visible checkpoints. Otherwise, I don't think you're looking for them, you know? If you picked a grass strip runway and it snowed a foot last night, you have to revise your decision on that. That's not good. I mean, most grass strips are pretty bad, although everybody who flies out of CLOW knows this one grass strip, and I finally had to learn where it was because they all use it and they all know where exactly it is. But most grass strips you're not going to find. So pick things that are easily identifiable. After we talk about your checkpoints initially, we'll also talk about which ones wouldn't work very well at night. Well, in the middle of the screen there is a river. So that's not going to work. At that point, I might ask you, if you wanted to use that checkpoint at night, how would you set up the VOR, just so that I know you can use a VOR? So you'd have to say you'd set it up on about the, looks like the 119, 115 radial, and will it say to or from? It'll say from. Some people like to do it the other way. If it works for you, it's fine, but you're going to have to reverse it when you get to your instrument ratings, so you might as well do it with froms like everybody else does. Here's another river. That wouldn't work very well at night. Then we'll talk about these airports. Get into some lighting. Up, let's see, where do we have it? Well, we've got the landings up there, that private airport. Which one? Would that be more visible than, say, DeKalb? Well, they both have a beacon because they both have a star on them. The landings doesn't have any runway lights. DeKalb says it has runway lights. I'll say, well, do you think they'll be on or do you have to turn them on? And the star in front of the L suggests that you have to turn them on. So know what these symbols mean as far as the airport lighting, and that'll get you through that part of it. We talk about the altitude that you're going to take this trip at. If we're going west, most people will pick 4,500 feet. The way I would start the question, though, is what things go into your decision to pick an altitude? Well, if you pick 4,500 feet and the ceiling's 2,900 feet, we got a problem. So we should be able to talk about the ceilings. I'd like to be able to talk about the ceilings and have you know that the weather reports are AGL and that you're planning in MSL, so there's a difference around here of about 600 or 700 feet. A lot of people start getting panicky and confused at that point. So I kind of have been leaving that one go a little bit because people are not too clear on that. But we do like to talk about the odds and evens rule, the hemispheric rule, and how it would affect this flight. So I'll suggest that we could take this trip to Cedar Rapids at 3,200 feet. Is that okay? Well, this is ultimately going to answer the question, does the hemispheric rule start at 3,000 AGL or MSL? And it starts at 3,000 AGL. If we're indicating 3,200 feet around here, we are within that. And frankly, no one will ever be flying at that altitude, because after the checkride, everybody forgets that that's an AGL rule. So it's one of my personal favorite altitudes to fly at, because nobody's there and nobody's going to hit me. That's another thing. Why is everybody flying at 2,500 feet? Just so we all bunch up and more likely to hit each other? I know it's nice and orderly on the altimeter, but it makes me extremely nervous. So that's the kind of situational awareness we'd like to see you demonstrate. So if you have your own little favorite things to do and you know things that you want to do to avoid densely populated areas, be sure to let me know that. So once we've decided that 3,200 feet is okay and 4,500 feet is okay, I will definitely talk to you about what's the lowest altitude that would be safe. Now, sometimes people start looking at each little tower along, well, maybe the most popular answer right then is 1,000 feet. Well, that doesn't answer everything. It tells me you know the altitude over a populated area. By the way, do you know how many people have to be together on the ground for it to be populated? Three. So assume anywhere you are where there's any human habitation is a populated area. There was a court case. And so that was what determined three people is a populated area. So if I point to this little podunk town here and say, what's the lowest you could fly over that town? You better tell me that you're going to be 1,000 feet above and that the altimeter would read in that area, it looks about 1,800 feet. So we need to know that you know these regulations. But the other part of the question is, are you going to miss all the obstacles? And on the way to Cedar Rapids, the biggest number is 24. So we have to know that these numbers are MSL and that you will clear the obstacle if the altimeter is perfect. But it's not enough to be legal, and you don't want to be playing with it that much. So the answer to minimum safe altitude between here and Cedar Rapids would be something above 2,400 feet. Now you see the blue arrow above that. What I'd ask there is if you're right there by that checkpoint and the visibility drops to 2 miles and you're at your 4,500 feet, is it legal to be there? So here's a scenario style question that calls on your factual knowledge. So you have to know that you're in E airspace and that you need 3 miles visibility. So can you solve this problem? Is there any airspace you could get to that would be legal? And you have to know then where to get to the G airspace. So we need to know then that the G airspace extends 1,200 feet AGL where it's not shaded magenta. In fact, the whole chart is shaded blue, but people have lost track of that because we don't have any of the charts that have the tan on them. But this is all shaded blue, so this is all 1,200 feet of G. And any magenta area is 700 feet of G airspace. So for this deviation, due to the poor visibility, you'd have to go down to about 2,000 feet initially. And then when you got close to this airport I'm going to have you deviate to, you'd have to get lower than that. Now on your way to that airport, you're going to run the risk of hitting those towers. So I'll give you a story that, you know, you want to deviate to that airport because of the poor weather, but you have a choice to make. You can either guarantee you'll miss the towers by violating the regulation and staying high, or you can descend and take your chances with the towers in order to comply with the regulation. Well, first of all, there is no air cop up there watching you, so you could just say, hey, it was 3 miles. And besides this, you are allowed to violate the regulation in order to maintain your safety. So I'm just checking to see that you have a pilot-in-command demeanor about you and that you understand that you have to make these decisions for safety's sake and not just to be in total compliance with a controller. So we'll talk about that. A lot of times people say, well, I'll go to a different airport. Or you could say you want to get a special into Cedar Rapids at that point, too. Now, if it's nighttime and you're at this last checkpoint I have marked up there, say it's nighttime, the weather's been deteriorating. These are real stories that we take these scenarios from. The weather's been deteriorating. You tried turning back, but the weather is worse behind you. So you're not flying into bad weather. It's just getting bad. So it's worse behind you, and it's nighttime. You listen to the ATIS at Cedar Rapids, and they say the ceiling is 900 feet and the visibility is 2. What are you going to do? Well, again, we're testing not only do you understand regulations, but mainly do you recognize how dangerous the situation is. The only really good thing you can do here is call Cedar Rapids and confess. I don't think you'll even have to say the word emergency because this guy's not going to have you crash into something out there after you called him up. Now, a lot of people will say, I'll call and get a special. Well, if you're a VFR-only pilot, you can't get a special. But I will give you credit for the right answer because he's not going to turn you away, even if you said the wrong words. He will recognize that you are in danger. He'll say, I can't give you a special, but I'll give you some help. So he'll vector you to the airport. Well, after we've heard this horror story, and if you live through this, you'd be pretty nervous. So what are you going to do when you get there to avoid landing on a taxiway. How embarrassing after he saved your neck. And this is a simple question. It's what color are the runway lights is the question. You land between the white lights, not between the blue lights. So it's just a, you know, a little more interesting way of getting the same information out of you. We'll talk about whether Cedar Rapids Tower is open all night. Can we tell? A lot of people want to bring out the facilities directory, but you don't have to go that far. All you need to do, really, is see on the chart there that there's a star after the tower frequency, which suggests it's part-time, and that you should look up the hours. The C following that also suggests that it's part-time and answers the next question, which is what frequency would you transmit on if the tower was closed? And so some people want to say 122.95, but that was the guy who sells gas, and he went home when the tower closed. So the correct answer is you talk where the C is, and that's on 118.7. It's not always going to be the tower frequency, but it's wherever the C is. If you're lost somewhere out here, and the VOR antennas become detached from the radio, and the batteries are dead on the GPS, how are you going to find yourself? Well, okay. So we got a climb is good, river is good. You're looking for prominent landmarks. 121.5. May not be the first thing you want to do because you get so many people helping you that it might be distracting. Any other suggestions for frequencies or people with flight service? You want to give me some frequencies? No. 122.2. Very few people are saying that these days. I guess that's just because it's supposed to be in your head and it's not printed somewhere except on the legend. So 122.2 should work, but you might get the wrong flight service station. So if you want to get a specific one, you can use the VOR. And up here it says 122.1R. Well, it's nice, very useful and important that you know that they receive on that number and you would listen on the VOR. Oh. That's true.
That's why I went to 121.5.
You were right.
The other one is if you knew you were close to the hard zone. Try to get a hold of that.
Right. Right.
I climb first.
Climb is good. Climb is always good. And descending to look at water towers.
I've done that.
I mean, people do it and it works, but we really don't want to suggest that kind of behavior. Really good if I put you out in the wide open spaces, because I'm not going to, it'll be too easy for you to call this TIRSA.
I'm still climbing.
You're still, well, climbing's good. Yeah, we're not on the water towers anymore. So if you look in your facilities directory and you find an airport that you're near, you'll find a radar frequency for them. Or you can even be a private pilot and say, look, my instructor gave me this old set of approach plates, so I'm just going to look up this airport, and it tells me the frequency that radar serves that airport. So these are good cockpit resources for you to be able to use and refer to. Oh, we have a little confusion when we're over Rockford, though. That's always a problem. Then there's two ways you can communicate over the Rockford VOR. The 122.55 goes both ways, if it says 55. And then it's a combination on the other one. So we'll be talking about equipment requirements for this trip. And as you know, we started off at DuPage, so we're under the Bravo airspace and inside the veil, so we need a Mode C transponder. We also need Mode C when we get to Cedar Rapids. we also will ask, I'll ask you if you fly over the top of Cedar Rapids at 6,500 feet, do you need the Mode C? Well, some people think because their airspace stops at 49 that you don't need it, but you do, because that's the way the reg is written, within the lateral limits and above. So in theory, you could duck under this shelf without a Mode C, like the, you know, the crop duster probably does. But, you know, obviously we'd prefer to have Mode C wherever we're operating around these places. Anyway, so on top of Charlie, you need the Mode C as well. Can we land at Green Castle without a two-way radio? Well, that means that you understand that there's a shelf that you could duck under and not have to talk to anybody. Not that I'm recommending it, but you don't have to talk if you stay under 2,100 feet, and that's an MSL number. So then we get to the Rockford situation. Some confusion about this. Most people treat it as if it were Class Charlie, which is fine, kind of what they expect, and kind of the level of service that you like to get from these people. But the fact is, if you're going to fly through that airspace, you're, you know, through the TRSA airspace, it's pretty voluntary, everything you do. So the question I like to get at the core of the situational awareness here is, what's the lowest you can fly over these runways at Rockford in your Cub that has no radios? Anybody want to answer it? Or? Exactly. Very good. You didn't even need to come today. 3201, because the Delta airspace only goes up to 3,200 feet. A lot of people answer 8,000 feet, but that's just the voluntary airspace where they can give you some services. We had the radio failure when we were at Cedar Rapids, by the way. We'll say radios fail when you're at that checkpoint, or you make a transmission, get no response. What steps do you take? Well, I'd like to hear you say you're going to try the other radio, you're going to check the volume, try a different frequency, see if you're receiving EATIS, you know, do a little work in the cockpit, check the switching panel, check your headset. One of my newsletters talks about troubleshooting radio failures. So go through that. There's lots of ways to screw up the radios, and I've been guilty of it myself. So you learn the hard way sometimes. So you can't get them to respond. Can you continue into their airspace? And the answer is no. I'm going to say you have plenty of gas and it's a nice day. So if they never answer you, you're going to go there and land. Probably not your best idea unless you want to fill out some paperwork. So then my next suggestion would be to tell you that there is, in fact, a great radio shop at Rockford. And everybody would be so happy if you could get the radios fixed on this plane. Can we get into Rockford? Well, again, some people might be intimidated by this TRSA airspace, but really it's a Delta airport. And so you can get in there. How do you get in there without radios? You fly over the traffic pattern at least 500 feet, but not over the Delta, because he won't even pay attention to you up there. So you want to fly 500 feet at least above the traffic pattern, observe what's going on, and wait for your light gun signals. What would that be? Steady green. That's the only one I ask. Hits the highlights on the cross-country stuff, but as you can see, I hope you understand that we're talking about scenarios. So a lot of people could write out the ceiling and visibility requirements when they have a chart of A through E or A through G airspace, but when you're asked about, you're in this situation, you kind of have to know what kind of airspace you're in if you're going to function well in the real world. Okay, then we have some airport markings, some pictures we're going to look at. This airspeed indicator obviously is color-coded on the original, clearly it's not a training aircraft, but it's possible that I'd ask you what you know about this airplane from the airspeed indicator. Because truly, memorizing airspeeds that appear on the airspeed indicator is sort of a waste of time. If you need to know the airspeed, it's right in front of you. So if you want to know when this airplane stalls with the flaps down, it looks like 61 knots. So know what these markings mean. Know that this yellow arc over here is smooth air only. Some people say, oh, never go in there, but you can go in there in smooth air. Maybe your Skyhawk won't get in there, but your Bonanza might. So understand what those markings are. Then the wind indicators. I don't know why people are not that familiar with the wind tee. It does cause people trouble. Just remember, it's a little airplane. You go the way the little airplane's going. So that you'd have to answer. We don't ask about these signals because they don't use them anyway. So unless you park in the wrong spot and then the signal they give you isn't on there. yeah, you'd recognize that one. In this upper corner here with this tetrahedron, that's an uncontrolled field. That's a tetrahedron, not a windsock. Which runway would you use? Well, you need to know the X's mean it's closed there. And you need to know that the wind actually favors 2-2, so your second choice would be 1-8. Is it right or left traffic? Well, it is right traffic to 1-8. I don't care if you have to turn the page around to figure that out, but it's right traffic. Some people think that that is a drawing of where you would fly it, so I'll have to ask them, if they move this device on the other side, do they change the L's over to the other side? There's some confusion about that. Now we're on this big airport down here in the lower right. What's the difference between the two green areas? Well, the one up here, I don't care if you know the name. I just want to know what you can do and what you can't do, because what you name it doesn't matter to me. A commercial pilot sure should know, but this is a displaced threshold. You can taxi and take off, but you can't land. This one with the chevrons is unusable. It's a blast pad, or you just crash there, overrun if you have to. If we're down here in the takeoff position for 3-5 left, and the tower's closed, and a 757 lands, big airplane, we're a small airplane, the tower's closed, how do you plan your takeoff after he has landed? This is the more complicated of the questions that you could get, because usually it's taking off after he takes off or landing after he lands, but I get them both in one question. So what you need to remember with wake turbulence is you just don't want to be airborne any place that he was airborne. Just don't want to be airborne. So you figure out where he touched down, and then you take off past that. Or tell me you're going to wait 3 minutes, because that would be adequate. I'll ask you if the is wake turbulence a bigger problem when there's 3 knots or 20 knots of wind? Well, 3 knots will let it hang together, and 20 knots will break it up. So 20 knots, I'd stop thinking about wake turbulence. We also get to talk about the land and hold short procedures on this picture. If you listen to the ATIS for this airport, they say they're landing and departing on 3-5 left and right, as well as 3-0. They also say on the ATIS that land and hold short procedures are in effect. When you call the tower, they say to report a 2-mile final for 3-5 left. When you call up on the 2-mile final, what else might you hear besides clear to land? And the answer is land and hold short of 3-0. Do you have to accept that clearance? Absolutely not, but you have to make it clear to him that you're not going to do it. He has to solve the problem some other way, give you the other runway or something. But that being the new hot button, we have to talk about it. Okay, we got to talk about systems. All right, vacuum system. You got to know which instruments are on the vacuum system. So I'll say, if you see low suction in the cockpit, what kind of trouble do you have? Some people like to name all the gyros, but we just want the two that are vacuum. So that's the artificial horizon, and our attitude indicator, and directional gyro. In the newer Cessnas, I'll ask the question, if LVAC illuminates on the annunciator panel, how much trouble are you in? Zero. Until you check the suction gauge, you have the right vacuum pump. So there are people out there that don't know they have two vacuum pumps in these brand new Cessnas. So it can't be considered a crisis if we take off every day in the older Cessnas with one vacuum pump. It's not a crisis. So it doesn't stand for low vacuum. It still stands for left vacuum. Pitot-static. Some people still don't know where the static source is on a Piper. It's on the back of the pitot tube. So that's one of the favorite Piper questions. If the static pitot or static source is blocked, is there anything you can do about it? You should know that there is alternate static and how to turn it on. And that there's pitot heat. Electrical problem. How do you know if you have an electrical problem when you're in flight? Well, there's lots of different things. You could have the electrical fire smell. You could have circuit breakers pop. You could have an annunciator light come on. You check the ammeter in a Cessna or the load meter in a Piper. The difference between the Cessna gauge and the Piper is the Piper is showing the rate that you're using the alternator, and the Cessna gauge is just showing you whether the alternator is keeping up with the load. So negative is bad in a Cessna, and zero is bad in a Piper. Zero would be good in a Cessna. Zero is bad in a Piper. So kind of know the difference between those gauges. If the light, the warning light comes on and the ammeter or load meter shows that the alternator is not working, what are you going to do? Well, one real good answer is to say, I'll get out the checklist, because at that point, I can't even quiz you anymore on it because the checklist has to be there. But I might, if you don't say I'm going to get out the checklist, then I'll say, what do you think you'll do? Well, everybody knows to reduce the load and land pretty soon. A lot of people don't know that you have a good chance of getting it restarted if you turn off the alternator and turn it back on. It works a lot of the time, and you can save yourself an unnecessary landing. How many people have had that cure a problem for them. No, it wouldn't cure it?
I wished it would, but it didn't.
Well, it's pretty common, real common. So that's a real good thing to know. And if you have this electrical failure and you can't get the alternator restarted, about how long do you think you have? Well, you know, if you know the capacity of the battery, you might be able to compute it, but we really can't because we don't know if the battery is sick because the alternator's been sick. So figure half an hour maybe if you reduce the load. And you might pretty much want to be on the ground or at least recognize what you're not going to have. What's the worst case outcome? Well, the engine's not going to quit. There's still some people out there that think it might. You won't have your radios. You won't have your turn coordinator. That's gone. And in a Cessna, you won't have your flaps. So the landing will be a little different. You might have to give that some thought before you turn final at your usual airspeed and can't get the flaps down. Okay, electrical problem and fuel and oil, capacities and sumps. Don't talk about that too much usually. Okay, the hypoxia. I'll say, are we going to get hypoxia on the trip that you've planned? And usually they're at 4,500. So the worst answer I ever had was a student, a young man, maybe 18 or 19, who looks at me and he said, well, I won't, but I don't know about you. So I gave him another kind of hypoxia. So I just sucked it up and continued in my professional manner. So anyway, he was talking about older people might have a problem. and diseased individuals. I don't know which he thought I was in, but anyway. So what you need to know is that at 10,000 feet, you're supposed to be thinking about it. At 5,000 feet at night, you should be thinking about it because your eyes function differently at night and it requires more oxygen. So that's what we need to know. The privates, I'll ask them at what altitude do the regulations start for oxygen, 12.5. Commercial should be able to recite them all the way up. Let's see. Carbon monoxide, any problems from using the cabin heater? Carbon monoxide poisoning. How would you recognize it? You know, dizzy, drowsy, red fingernails, as it turns out, not blue. And what would you do? Well, you got to land. Your judgment's impaired, you're sick, it's going to take a while to clear up. So open the vents, turn off the heat, thank you. Okay, let's see. A lot of people can't do an engine failure from high altitude. We're going to get back into that now that they've put the steep spiral back into the commercial test. But, if you lose the engine over, you're 4,000 feet over a big runway and you can't make the runway, your wife is going to be seriously disappointed, as well as the airplane owner. So that should be taught and practiced, even at the private level. And obviously, you're going to have to do an engine failure. You're not just going to just glide to the airport. You're going to tell me some things you're going to do. But don't be talking so much that you forget to turn base if we're at a runway, because you can talk yourself into not being able to get to the runway. So, set your priorities. Number one is getting to the airport. Number one is not telling the traffic pattern what you're doing, because I'm not going to give you the engine failure in a traffic pattern where there's a conflict. And plus, you are faced with a serious emergency, so stop keying the mic first thing anytime, like on a go-around. I've seen people key the mic a lot of times before they get rid of the flaps. Well, there's nobody in front of you, for God's sake. Who are you helping with this piece of information? It is a sign of bad priority picking if you talk to the controllers before you do anything else in an emergency, unless there's obviously some clear conflict that he needs to know about. Priorities, let's see. Okay, carburetor icing. How would you know if you had carburetor icing in a carbureted airplane? Well, you're going to have a loss of RPMs and a rough running engine. If you put the carb heat on and the first thing that happens is it sounds worse, does that mean it's some other problem? No, it means that it's probably carb ice unless it doesn't clear up within a minute or two, because you're putting the water through the engine. What kind of day would you expect carburetor icing? 20 to 70 Fahrenheit and high moisture content, which you can tell from the temperature dew point spread. Okay. Now, for the commercial people, let's just hit on some of the details that we didn't talk about already. We're going to talk more about what a commercial pilot can do. And a typical answer is not a whole lot more. But you should know your parameters and whether or not you can take money from another person for your flying activities. And kind of the way you think about it, you can't be holding yourself out. Well, that's kind of a strange way to put it. So the thing is, if somebody owns a 182 RG, you know how to fly it, they come to you and say, I want you to fly me to Peoria so I don't have to pay attention to the trip. Can you do that? Yes, you can. If his plane is broken, can you go find the airplane and do the same trip? And the answer is no, you can't, because then you're supplying your services and the airplane. So that's a good example. You can do crop dusting and banner towing if that was still lucrative. But so that's that kind of privileges we have to talk about. Obviously, we always talk about how long is a medical valid and whatnot. I'll get into more detail on the aircraft certification. Everybody gets a little discussion now about ADs. Question that I'll ask at the commercial level is, if there's an AD that is recurring every 100 hours, like the seat rails on a Skyhawk, if I own this airplane and it's 102 hours since the seat rails have been inspected, can I fly the airplane to the mechanic to have him inspect the seat rails? And the answer is no. A lot of people want to say yes, you could have 10 hours of grace, but there is no grace time on these ADs unless for some reason it was specified in there, but usually it's 500 hours and it has to be done. So the solution is you get a ferry permit from the FAA. It's just like if it's out of annual. So understand that about ADs, and that there's one time and recurring ADs, and be able to find them in the aircraft records. Minimum equipment, what has to be working on the airplane? The best way to work through this is to go through a series of checks. The first step in the series would be, what are the FAA requirements? Is it a day VFR? Is it an IFR flight? Those are spelled out for you in the requirements. I never ask people to list the stuff because, you know, it takes a while for me to list the stuff. But you know where to find it, you'll be able to comply. Next, we have to check the airplane's records. The airplane's manual that's in the aircraft has a list of equipment. That is not a minimum equipment list, because that is something entirely different. It is an equipment list. On that list, some things will be marked as required and some things are marked as optional. So everything that is required in there has to be on the airplane. The example I like to use with a commercial pilot, if he forgets to tell me about the equipment list, is, can you fly this Cessna without the spinner on it? Well, no. How do you know that? Well, you can't fly a Cessna without the spinner, but you can fly a Piper without the spinner. And that's something that you'd find on the airplane's equipment list. Then, of course, the pilot has to make a decision about whether he's satisfied with the equipment he has after he's met these other two lists. So if he's satisfied and he doesn't care if the ADF is working, then he can put a placard on it, make a note in the logbooks, so the rest of the pilots know. When you're doing your application, the qualifications, got to be real careful for your commercial pilot qualifications. There's a lot of confusion, and of the check rides that people show up to take and can't take because they're not qualified, commercial is number one. And the reason is because they've added in a couple of dual cross countries that you have to do before you get a commercial rating. And these cannot be the cross countries you did for your private, and they cannot be anything other than dual piloted. You can't use an instrument trip that you did. So you have to use, it's two new trips that you take with your instructor. And then the definition of solo. Somebody shows me an entry that they did their long cross country. Oh yeah, I went to Florida, stopping in Chattanooga and Miami, and came back. And his entry in his book says Cousin Joe. Well, it's not a valid trip because it wasn't solo. And it's not that he wasn't a pilot, it's that he's another person in the airplane. So solo is alone in the aircraft. There's also night solo requirements that people forget to meet on that. Night solo and 10 takeoffs and landings at a tower. So be sure you look at the FAR's specifically before you show up for your commercial test so that you're definitely qualified. We talked about how important pilotage is. We'll go into a lot more detail on airspace. We're supposed to get all the airspaces for both private and commercial, but I go into more detail on commercial because there's more of a chance that they're going to fly into O'Hare and perhaps into Alpha airspace. Systems, propeller is always more interesting in a complex airplane. You need to know a little bit about how that works. So we'll talk about that and how that would affect your indications of power loss. So if you had a 172RG and you got carb ice, where would you see that? Well, you're not going to see it on the RPMs. You're going to see it on the manifold pressure. So you have to kind of understand how that constant speed prop, although it's a nice feature, does hide some power failures from you. Obviously, the landing gear is a complicated system. You have to know about that. For these weight and balance for commercial, you have to do two, start of the trip, end of the trip, start of the trip, zero fuel. There'll be two. A little more detail maybe on aeromedical, and they want us to go into more of the night physiology. Pressurization if it's a pressurized airplane. okay. Thought if you have the patience to sit through this, the new maneuver on the, I'm sorry about the homemade drawing here. I forgot to make a transparency. This is the steep spiral that's been added to the commercial test. If you read everything you can find about it, there isn't a specified airspeed for this maneuver. You do have to spiral down over a designated point. I would suggest that you use an airspeed that's right around best glide because you're going to eat up less altitude and we won't have to climb to 7,000 feet to get three turns out of it. You're supposed to get three turns out of this. The problem with when you start really, really high is being close enough to the point. And what appears to be close enough to the point when you're really high is actually pretty far away from the point. Flight instructor applicants are going to be expected to know this because there's a lot of confusion about it. And the flight instructor applicant is going to have to do this from the right side to the left because he's demonstrating for the student. So the student gets to see the point and he may not see the point. So you have to spiral. Maybe you're using reference points around the point. But, you know, you have to do this and do the wind correction. The point of this maneuver, in my opinion, is to get down to the runway if you're over a runway when the engine quits. So it seems kind of natural to me that the concept here, if we're going to do this over an airport, like sometimes I'll have people spiral down over Sandwich when we divert on a commercial trip, because there's not a whole lot of traffic there. So I'd like to see you get the three turns if we started high enough. And then what is really great is if you can finish this emergency and get to the runway using that 180-degree power-off landing. The hang-up there, which was pointed, we discussed earlier, is that the 180-degree power-off landing to the runway is done with the gear down. And you may not feel like putting the gear down if you got a little low when you're spiraling down over the key point. But this key point, the X on the ground here, is to show you that you're spiraling down over the point that's a beam, the touchdown point. If you spiral down over the end of the runway, you're going to have to maneuver to get away from it. So spiraling down over the key point is designed to get you into a position where you're used to seeing the traffic pattern and you're used to evaluating the glide of the airplane from there. Now, if you couldn't, you know, if we tried this over a runway and you couldn't do the 180-degree turn as part of that, I can't force you to combine these. We would like to see you get to the runway, but if you ended up putting the gear down on final instead of a beam the touchdown point, then we'd just do another power-off 180-degree landing, and both those would be satisfactory. That's the highlights, although it seems like there were a lot. So our goal at the end here is to get you one of these, get you your temporary certificate. Doesn't look that neat when I handwrite one, but everybody thinks they're just great anyway, so that's our goal, and certainly I'm always happier if that's the way the check ride ends. I don't want to see anybody fail. I'll do anything I can to get you through, and so listen to what's being said. I generally don't just waste words. So, you know, if I say, so you think the heading is 210 to get there, might mean you ought to rethink your heading, you know, on a diversion, something like that. But I'll be glad to take any questions if you have any. But I appreciate your attention, and that's what I had for today.